Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we shall study about vermicomposting of solid waste. Solid waste are unwanted material which are disposed by man, which neither flow into water streams nor escape into atmosphere, as well as not of immediate use to the man. Solid waste are heterogeneous in nature, as these are produced by diverse activities of the man, including agricultural activities, domestic activities, commercial activities, industrial activities, etc. The disposal and management of solid waste have always been a challenge to the scientists, policy makers and urban local bodies, that is municipalities. Due to the prohibitive cost of solid waste management, people prefer to dispose solid waste in open dumps or do open burning. When solid waste are disposed in open dumps, that leads to spreading of infectious diseases, water pollution, soil pollution. When we do burning of solid waste, that leads to air pollution. Not only this, if we do open burning and open dumping of the solid waste, the nutrients which are present in the solid waste are lost forever. The scientists are of the view that new methods should be developed for the purpose of solid waste management. It has been recommended in the recent years that different biological methods such as biomethanation, composting and vermicomposting can be very useful for the management of solid waste. Not only this, if we use these methods, we not only control the pollution, but also recover the nutrients which are present in the solid waste. So, in this module, we shall discuss in details about vermicomposting. The learning objectives of this module are that what is vermicomposting, benefits of vermicomposting, types of earthworm used for the purpose of vermicomposting, process of vermicomposting, essential conditions for vermicomposting process, and nutritive value of vermicompost. It is very difficult to give a composition to the solid waste, because solid waste is produced by diverse activities. But Central Pollution Control Board, New Delhi, has given a empirical composition to the Indian municipality solid waste. According to that, about 40 to 45% material of the municipality solid waste is compostable in nature as well as non-toxic in nature. This is that fraction of the Indian municipality solid waste which can be used as raw material for the purpose of vermicomposting. In addition to this, other biodegradable non-toxic solid waste which are produced by the industries, commercial activities and agricultural activities can also be used for the purpose of vermicomposting. Vermicomposting is nothing but decomposition of biodegradable matter in good quality manure with the help of earthworms. This manure is called as vermicompost, and it can be used as soil conditioner in agricultural fields. The term vermicomposting is derived from the Latin word vermins means worms, and composting means degradation, means degradation of solid waste with the help of worms. Vermicomposting is a process by which earthworms mix, aerate and fragment the waste combined with the biodegradation process of microorganisms. Vermicompost, that is the product of vermicomposting process, is highly beneficial to the earthworms and plants, and it serves as water soluble, excellent nutrient rich, natural fertilizer and soil conditioner. There are about 4000 different types of earthworm species which are present all over the earth, but all earthworm species cannot be used for the purpose of vermicomposting. Depending upon the ecological niche, earthworms can be divided into three categories, that is epigeic earthworms, endogeic earthworms and anisic earthworms. Epigeic earthworms lives upon the earth endozoic earthworms live within the earth, anasic earthworms live out of the earth. There are about 500 species of earthworms which are present in India. Out of these 520 species, only 20 species can be used for the purpose of vermicomposting. So, what should be the characteristics of the earthworm species used for the purpose of vermicomposting? The earthworm species which is used for the purpose of vermicomposting, that should have wide adaptability to environmental factors, particularly to the temperature, wide adaptability for organic materials as feed or raw materials or substrate. The earthworm species which is used for the purpose of vermicomposting should have high rate of high growth and reproduction rate, high feeding rate, lesser inactivity period to new feeds, and the earthworm species should be compatible or tolerant with earthworms if polyculture system of vermicomposting is used. The common species which are used for the purpose of vermicomposting are Icenia foetida, that also called as red vigilers, Icenia underi, Eudrilis eugenii, Perionox excavatus, Lumbericus rubellus, that is called as red worms, Lumbericus terrestris, night crawlers, and Lampito maruci. Among these species, Icenia foetida and Eudrilis eugenii are widely used at commercial level for the purpose of vermicomposting. When we do vermicomposting, then these are not only the earthworms. Along with earthworms, many other microorganisms are present in the vermicomposting bin. The other microorganisms and worms which are present in the vermicomposting bin include mites and flies, predatory planarians, centipedes and millipedes, white worms, springtails, isopods, bacteria, mold, fungi. We can say that vermicomposting bin is like a circus in which earthworm is the ringmaster, and the habitable conditions for the earthworm are produced by the other microorganism, flora or fauna, which is present in the vermicomposting bin. Vermicomposting process can be of open type of vermicomposting or in container vermicomposting. In container vermicomposting is carried out in the enclosed spaces. Open vermicomposting system, also called as windrow vermicomposting system. The different types of windrow systems are low cost floor beds, gentry fed beds, raised gentry fed beds, and Dorset wedge style beds. In container vermicomposting systems include different types of bins, batch reactors, continuous flow system, and tray or stacking systems of vermicomposting. The different steps of vermicomposting. Vermicomposting process is carried out in a number of steps. The major steps of vermicomposting process are collection and separation of solid waste. This phase involves the collection of waste followed by processing, which involves shredding, mechanical separation of the metal, glass, ceramic, and storage of organic waste. The second step of vermicomposting process is digestion of organic waste. Organic wastes are pre-digested or semi-composted for 3 to 5 weeks by heaping the raw material along with cattle dung. This process partially digest or semi-compose the material to make it palatable to the earthworm. Cattle dung and biogas slurry may be used after drying or semi-composting. Wet dung should not be used for the purpose of vermicomposting, because wet dung may lead to production of heat as well as toxic gases, which may be harmful to the earthworms or which may lead to mortality of earthworms in the vermicomposting process. Next step of vermicomposting is preparation of earthworm bed. For carrying out vermicomposting, a concrete base is required to put the waste and loose soil which allow the worms to go into soil. Also, while watering, all the dissolvable nutrients go into the soil along with water. Next step is collection of vermicompost. The completely composted material is separated from the partially composted material by sieving. The partially composted material will again be put in the vermicomposting bed for complete composting, and the final step is storage of the vermicompost. The vermicompost produced during the vermicomposting process is not immediately used. It is allowed to stabilize for some time, and for the stabilization, the vermicompost is stored in proper place to maintain the moisture and to allow the beneficial microorganism to grow. Survival of the earthworm during the vermicompost is very, very important. For the survival of the earthworm in the process, we have to maintain certain conditions. First and most important is the bedding material. Any material that provides the worms with a relatively stable habitat is good for bedding, and the characteristics of a good bedding are that it should have high absorptivity, that is moisture. The bedding must be able to absorb and retain water fairly well for the worms to thrive. The bedding material should have good bulking potential, that is aeration. The bedding material should be packed in such a way that there is an adequate supply of air to support the life of the worms. If the material is too dense or packed too tightly, then the flow of air is reduced, and as a result, the worm cannot survive. The bedding material should have low protein and or nitrogen content, means we are talking about the raw material or food source. Low protein or nitrogen source is suitable condition for the worms, because high protein or nitrogen level can result in rapid degradation and its associated heating, creating inhospitable, often fatal to the earthworms. Moreover, heating can occur safely in the food layers of the vermicomposting system, but not in the bedding. Process of the production of vermicompost. The foremost step for the vermicomposting is the selection of a suitable earthworm. Out of about 500 species of earthworms found in India with varied food and burrowing habits, the red worms, that is Aicinia foetida, African earthworm, that is Eudryllus eugeni, and composting worm, that is Peryonox excavatus, are some of the species that are reared or used to convert solid waste into vermicompost or manure. The African worm are much preferred over the other two species because it produces high production of vermicompost in short period of time. Selection of suitable location. Sheltered culturing of worms is recommended to protect the worms from excessive sunlight and rain. Vermicomposting process requires shaded place with high humidity and a cool environment. The waste heaped for vermicompost production are to be covered with moist gunny bags. This helps in maintaining the moisture as well as keeping away the predators. Selection of containers. Cement tanks are constructed to a height of 2 feet, a width of 3 feet, and with the length depending upon the size of the room. The bottom of the tank is made to slope to drain the excessive water for vermicompost unit, and a small sump is built to collect the drained water. The drained water which is collected from the vermi bed, that is called as vermi wash. Vermi wash is a very good liquid fertilizer which can be used for the horticultural crops. In a small scale, vermi compost can also be prepared in wooden boxes, plastic buckets, or in any container with a drain hole at the bottom. Vermicomposting bed. Vermicomposting bed is prepared by placing sawdust, husk or coir waste or sugarcane trash in the bottom of the container. A layer of fine sand is spread over the culture bed followed by a layer of garden soil. The layers are moistened with water. Bedding material. The selection of bedding material is a key to successful vermiculture or vermicomposting. Shredded paper or cardboard makes an excellent bedding, particularly when combined with typical on-farm organic resources such as straw and hay. Paper mill sludge, which has the high absorbency and small particle size, complements the high CN ratios and good bulking properties of straw, bark or wooden shavings. Warm food or raw material or substrate for vermicomposting. Vermicomposting earthworms are very big eater. They eat almost everything which is organic in nature. Under ideal condition, they are able to consume in excess of their body weight each day. Although the general rule of thumb is that half of their body weight per day. The body weight of each earthworm is about 1 gram. So, in general, they can consume about 0.5 gram per day. Manures are the most commonly used worm feedstock or substrates, with dairy and beef manures generally considered the best natural foods of the earthworms. Biodegradable waste such as cattle dung, farm waste, crop residues, vegetable market waste, flower market waste, agro-industrial waste, fruit market waste, etc. are suitable raw material for vermicompost production. In general, we can say any biodegradable material which is non-toxic in nature and having a suitable CN ratio can be an excellent raw material or substrate for the purpose of vermicomposting. Before vermicomposting, animal dung or any substrate should be pre-digested or semi-composted for 3 to 5 weeks. When this material is semi-composted, it is palatable to the earthworms. The pre-digested waste material is mixed with 30% cattle dung and then placed in the vermi bin or container. The moisture level is usually maintained at 60 to 70%. Selected earthworms are placed uniformly over the material in the bed or in the bin that has to be vermicomposted. There is no need to put the earthworms inside the waste as they move inside on their own. Roughly for 1 meter length, 1 meter breadth and 0.5 meter height of the vermi bed, 1 kilogram of earthworms or about 1000 of earthworms are sufficient. The moisture should be maintained at 60 to 70% throughout the vermicomposting process. The daily watering of vermi bed is not required, but water should be sprinkled over the bed if necessary. Harvesting of vermicompost and or worm casting formed on the top layer is done periodically, that may be once in a week. Watering should be stopped before the harvest of vermicompost. The castings are scooped out with hand and placed as heap in a shady place. The harvesting of casting should be limited up to earthworm presence on top layer. Periodical harvesting is necessary for free flow and to retain the quality of vermicompost, or the free or the finished compost get compacted when watering is done. After the vermicompost production, the earthworms present in the bed that may be harvested by trapping method, where small fresh cow dung balls are made and inserted inside the bed in 5 or 6 places. After 24 hours, the cow dung balls are removed. All the worms will be adhered into the ball, and putting this cow ball in a bucket of water will separate these adhered worms. The collected worms will be used for next batch of composting. At large scale vermicomposting facilities, the earthworms are separated from the vermicompost by using the hand winnowing or the machine winnowing methods. The harvested vermicompost should be stored in cool, dark place with a minimum 40% moisture. Vermicompost should not be exposed to sunlight, as this may lead to loss of moisture and nutrient content. It is recommended that the harvested vermicomposted material be openly stored with periodical sprinkling of water to maintain moisture level and also to maintain beneficial microbial populations. If needed, the material can be stored in laminated over sack, as this will minimize the moisture evaporation loss. Vermicompost can be stored for a year without loss of its quality if the moisture is maintained at about 40% level. Packaging is done at the time of selling the vermicompost. The nutrient content of vermicompost depends on the waste or raw material or substrate used for the vermicompost production. If the raw material are heterogeneous in nature, there will be wide range of nutrients available in the vermicompost. If the waste materials are homogeneous one, there will be only certain nutrients available in the vermicompost. The common available nutrients in vermicompost are organic carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, sodium, calcium, and magnesium. In addition to this, certain trace elements such as copper, iron, zinc, along with sulfur are also present. Now, what are the benefits of vermicompost? Vermicompost, due to its rich nutrient content, serve as an excellent manure or fertilizer to improve soil fertility. The worm casting contains 5 times the available nitrogen, 7 times the available potassium, and 1.5 times more calcium, phosphorus, and magnesium than found in good topsoil. It has excellent porosity, excellent structure, excellent drainage properties, and excellent aeration and water holding capacity, and prevents soil erosion. Microbial activity in vermicompost is higher than the soil and organic matter from which the vermicompost has been produced. It is rich in beneficial microflora such as phosphorus solubilizers, nitrogen fixers, cellulose decomposing microflora, and the enzymes such as phosphatase and cellulose released enrich the soil microbes. Vermicompost contains earthworm cocoons and increases the population and activity of earthworm in the soil. Vermicompost attracts deep burrowing earthworms already present in the soil. It enhances the decomposition of organic matter in soil. Vermicompost is free from pathogens, toxic elements, weed seeds, etc. It also prevents nutrient loss and increases the use efficiency of chemical fertilizers. Application of vermicompost in agricultural soils play an important role in the plant growth, because vermicomposts are rich in all essential plant nutrients including NPK. The nutrients rich property of the vermicompost produced by the earthworm enhance germination, plant growth, as well as crop yield. It also improves root length and structure. It improves quality and shelf life of the product produced from those plants for which vermicompost has been used. It contains valuable vitamins, enzymes, and hormones like auxins, gibberellins, etc. Vermicompost also minimizes the incidence of pests and diseases. Biowaste conversion by vermicomposting reduces waste flow to the landfills. Hence, this is a very economical method. It creates low skill jobs at local level with low capital investment and relatively simple technologies for lesser developed agricultural regions. Application of vermicompost has several environmental benefits also. The use of vermicomposting, the generation of greenhouse gases emission such as methane and nitric oxide produced in landfills or incinerators are reduced. Vermicompost is free flowing, easy to apply, handle and store, and does not have bad or foul odor. Ministry of Agricultural and Rural Development, Department of Agriculture and Cooperation, in the Fertilizer Control Order 1985, has given the specific characteristics or the quality of the vermicompost. According to this, the moisture in the vermicompost should be in the range of 15% to 25%. The color of vermicompost should be dark brown to black. If the vermicompost is dark brown to black in color, this indicates this is highly stabilized and has good amount of humic acids. It should be free from foul odor, rather it should have earthy odor. The particle size, 90% material should pass through 4 mm sieve. The bulk density of the vermicompost should be 0.7 to 0.9 gram per centimeter cube. Minimum content of the total organic carbon in the vermicompost should be 18%. The minimum content of total nitrogen in the vermicompost should be 1%. The minimum total phosphorus content as P2O5 should be 1%. The minimum potassium content as K2O should be 1%. In addition to this, standards for the heavy metals are also given. The arsenic content should be lesser than 10 milligram per kilogram. Similarly, cadmium should be lesser than 5 milligram per kilogram. Chromium should be lesser than 50 milligram per kilogram. Mercury should be lesser than 0.15 milligram per kilogram. Nickel should be lesser than 50 milligram per kilogram, and lead should be lesser than 100 milligram per kilogram of vermicompost. Several people do vermicomposting in the open. Vermicomposting in open is not a recommended method. If we use this type of open system for the purpose of vermicomposting, that time the earthworms can be eaten up by the predators, particularly by the birds and rats. So, it is always advised not to do vermicomposting in this type of systems. This picture shows the concrete vermi beds covered with the crop residues. This type of system should be used for the purpose of vermicomposting. This picture shows another type of the vermi beds which are used for the purpose of vermicomposting. You will see in this picture, there are two channels outside the vermi beds. In the first channel, water is allowed to flow because ants are the enemies of the earthworms. If we allow the water to flow in this channel, that time ants cannot cross this channel. So, the earthworms will be protected from the ants. And the second channel that collect the liquid which is leached out from the vermi beds. This liquid, as shown in the another slide, can be collected in a pit. This liquid is called as vermi wash. This is a very good quality liquid manure and can be used for horticultural crops. In the urban areas, 4-chambered bin for the purpose of vermicomposting are recommended. As shown in this picture, in the 4-chambered vermicomposting bin, the walls are perforated. In the first chamber, waste is added and it is allowed to be semi-composted. When the material is semi-composted, after 3 to 5 weeks, earthworms are allowed to grow in it. Earthworms will feed on this material, and in the meantime, we will start putting the fresh material in the second chamber. When all the material will be converted into vermicompost in the first chamber, through the perforated wall, the earthworms will shift from one chamber to the second chamber. So, this way we can complete this process. This is another type of vermicompost used by the people. Here, as this picture shows, instead of making the shed The people have cultivated the jatropha plants. So, in this type of vermicomposting system, they get one extra product, that is the jatropha seeds, which can be used for the production of biodiesel. This is another system which is used at the rural level to collect the vermivash. In this case, the vermi beds are given an angle of 5 degrees, so all the liquid is collected in these containers and used in horticultural crops. Students, now to sum up this module. In this module, we have learned that what is vermicomposting, how this process is carried out, what are the benefits of the vermicomposting process, what are the uses and benefits of the vermicomposts, and what should be the qualities of the vermicompost. Thank you.